Hi, and welcome to day 11 of Wave. I'm Daniel Bogdanoff. We'll draw today's winner in a bit, but first we have our daily tip, which if you're lucky, will improve your cable TV viewing. That is, if you still have cable.
Hey everyone, my name is Nick Ben. And did you know that splitters are found almost everywhere and that they are very useful? Have you ever wondered how they are affecting your own TV viewing at your house? Let's find out. If you have two TVs in your house, you probably have one of these splitters. Frequently, these splitters are used to split a signal from your cable box to multiple TVs. If you have a field FAQs handy, you can easily characterize insertion loss or S21 parameter on your splitter. And with the limit lines on a field FAQs, you can quickly tell if your device has either passed or failed. Here, I'm measuring a splitter similar to a TV splitter that you might have at home. Insertion loss or S21 is a measurement of the loss of your signal from one port to another. So if your cable provider is providing 1 mW of signal to your house, how much of that signal is actually getting to your TV? Because if you don't have a good signal, then you won't be able to see if the ball passed the goal line in a very tight play. There are other factors at play, but for today, let's ignore cable loss and just focus on the splitter. If this is your splitter, what would you expect the loss to be? Let's go back to college for a minute and remember our basic circuits class. This is a 2-resistor splitter, so you would expect the loss to be 6 dB. We'll test the math and set a limit line to see if it holds true on this actual splitter. Under the limit key, I'll select Edit Limits and set this to an upper limit. With amplitude of minus 6 dB. Then exit. Under the Options tab, Field FAQs has a warning feature that shows you pass or fail. Finally, let's put a marker on and read out the exact loss we are measuring. You can see here that the loss is, in fact, slightly more than minus 6 dB due to some loss from the cable. With only a 6 dB loss, you should be able to see that key play. So if you need to ensure that your device is performing as expected, be sure to use limit lines. For more information about measuring insertion loss, see your application note, Understanding the Fundamental Principles of Vector Network Analysis.
And that VNA app note is available over in the Wave Library. There's a link for it in the description. The Wave Library is going away on Monday, so make sure to go save off anything you want to read later. Before we get to our drawing, we have one more quick tip for the day. A quick bonus for today, we have a brand new AC power source, the AC6800B series. They're all pretty beefy. They can go up to 310 volts AC, so you can test things like commercial lighting setups. And the biggest one can even provide up to 4,000 volt amps. One of the really cool things that you can do with this type of supply is make both AC and DC measurements. So obviously voltage and current measurements, but you can also make like apparent power, real power, and reactive power, just to name a few. So because we have a chance to play with some new gear today, we thought we'd test out one of those universal power supply adapters that should work anywhere in the world and see how it handles a suite of global voltages. And we have this light setup with some resistors on the back end to act as our load. And for this, I'm gonna bring out Bill, who's one of our power guys here at Keysight. Hey Bill, how you doing?
Good, thanks Daniel, really appreciate it.
Now, you could run all these tests manually. There's buttons for frequency and voltage on the front panel, but I know you like to step things up a little bit, so can you show us what you have today?
Absolutely. So what we've done is we've created a Excel spreadsheet with voltages and frequencies that are used in 11 different countries for demonstration. So we're going to actually have the AC source output each of those voltages and frequencies, and then it's going to make some measurements, and it's going to bring them back and populate our Excel spreadsheet with those measurements.
Awesome.
Very cool. Let's go ahead and get started. So the first thing we'll do is we'll go ahead and open our connection to the AC source, which we've done. Well, next we're going to go ahead and put our AC source in a known state. So as you can see, our light has turned on now and it's outputting voltages also from the front panel. It's already making measurements. So let's go ahead and run through our loop, which we'll go ahead and test out each of those countries' voltages and frequencies. So it's making measurements now, and you can see the table's getting populated as it goes down through each of the voltages and frequencies. One of the cool things about this is a dual range source. And to speed this test up, we're using only the highest range, which gives us all the voltages. And had we needed higher current at less than 135 volts, we could have used the lower range, but it really wasn't necessary for this test. Go ahead, it just completed. And then we'll go ahead and close our connection.
So we just stepped through 11 different countries' voltages and frequency settings in 11 seconds, essentially.
Yes.
So that's pretty useful. So what have we learned from the measurements that we made about our power supply?
Absolutely. The thing that is really important about the AC source is that it actually gives us extremely stable voltages, and our results are very repeatable. And so you'll notice in the table we have a couple of countries that use the exact same voltage and same frequencies, and you'll see the results are the same or similar. And if we were to run this test again tomorrow, we'd actually get the same results. And you don't really find this. If you've ever tried to make these power measurements using just the power that comes out of the wall, there's enough fluctuation in voltage that it's really hard to get results that are repeatable. So this AC source really helps when you're trying to make.
Awesome. So you mentioned earlier when we were talking, like between our wall outlet and the actual source of our power, there's miles, potentially miles and miles of cable. And there's who knows what sort of like interference or reactive, you know, influences are on that power. So if you, like Bill said, if you've made power measurements off the wall, you'll see it fluctuate. So you may get different measurements day to day. So that's why you'd want to use an actual dedicated AC source for that power stability.
Correct. So you get the source plus you get the measurements all in one.
Awesome. And we'll put a link for these in the video description, the new AC6800B series power supplies. Pretty cool. Thanks for coming out, Bill.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And now let's draw today's winner. Remember, you have one more chance after today to win a bench bundle or an RF bundle. And today's winner is Paul Looper. Congratulations, Paul. We will be in touch with you shortly. Also, the winner of the quiz contest for the South Asia Pacific countries is Ruben Tet. We will also be in touch with you shortly. Make sure to tune in tomorrow at 10 a.m. Mountain Standard Time for our last wave video and some live QA, so bring your questions. Finally, we have a new scope promotion running. If you buy a new 3000, 4000, or 6000 X-Series scope and an app bundle, you get your choice of free probe, and there's some pretty nice options. There's a 2 gigahertz single-ended active probe, a 200 megahertz differential active probe, a probe with a high-gain channel and a low-gain channel for wide dynamic range measurements, or a 2 gigahertz power rail probe. Also, make sure to subscribe to the Keysight Labs YouTube channel, and I'll see you tomorrow in our live stream. In other news, we're going to start incorporating corporate sponsorship clips into our video to help offset our cost of production. Today's video brought to you by Keysight. I can't believe we had to do that.